These ones done?
They're in process. I have to study them now.
Study them?
Most of art is thinking. Didn't they teach you that? 10% is putting paint on canvas. The rest is waiting. All my life I've wanted just this, my friend. To create a place. A place where the viewer could contemplate the art over time and give it some of the care and attention that I gave it. Like a chapel, a place of communion.
But it's a restaurant.
No. I will make it a temple.
Chinese place is closing.
Everything worthwhile ends. We're in a perpetual process. Creation, maturation, cessation.
There's another one opening around the corner.
The eternal circles grind on. Generations pass away. Hope turns out. But there's another Chinese around the corner.
Not much for small talk.
It's small.
Yeah, I went to the monitor last night, saw the Picasso show.
And?
I don't think he's so much concerned with generations passing away.
Don't kid yourself. That man, though now, a charlatan, of course, signing menus for money like Dolly, when he's not making ugly little pots, also for money. That man, at his best, understood the workings of time. Where's the receipt? Tragic, really. To grow superfluous in your own lifetime. We destroyed Cubism, de Kooning and me, and Pollock and Barnett Newman and all the others. We stomped it to death. Nobody can paint a Cubist picture now.
You take pride in that, stomping Cubism to death.
The child must banish the father, respect it, but kill him.
And enjoy it?
Doesn't matter, just be audacious and do it. Fear in painting isn't facing the blank canvas. It's facing Monet. It's facing Velasquez. All we can hope to do is move beyond what was here to what is here and try to get some information of what will be here, what's past, passing, and yet to come. That's it, whom you haven't read.
Yeah, but Picasso.
Picasso, I thank for teaching me that movement is everything. Movement is life. The second we're born, we squall, we ride, we squirm. To move is to live. Without movement, the paintings are what?
Are you really gonna paint?
The hell do you think I have been doing? Give me black number 4, in the first maroon. Just a squeeze of black, just the same again. And now twice that much maroon. Come on. Come on. Come on, what does it need?
Red.
I wasn't talking to you! Don't you ever do that again! By what right did you speak? By what right did you make a finger on my work? Who the fuck are you? What have you done? What have you seen? Where have you had the right to exist here with me and these things you don't understand? Red, you want to paint it? Here's red. And red. And red. And red. I don't even know what that means. What does red mean to me? You mean scarlet? You mean crimson? You mean plum mulberry? Magenta? Burgundy? Salmon? Carmine? Carnelian? Coral? Anything but red. What is red?
I meant sunrise.
Sunrise?
I meant the red at sunrise. The feeling of it.
Oh, the feeling of it. What do you mean, the feeling of it?
I didn't just mean red paint. I meant The emotion of red at sunrise.
Sunrise isn't red.
Yes, it is.
I'm telling you, it's not.
Sunrise is red, and red is sunrise. Red is heartbeat. Red is passion. Red wine, red lipstick, beets, tulips, peppers.
Arterial blood?
That too.
Rust on the bike and the lawn.
Apples and tomatoes.
Dresden firestorm. The sun in Rousseau, the flag in Delacruz, the robe in El Greco.
A rabbit's nose, an albino's eyes, a parakeet.
Florentine marble, atomic flash. Nick yourself shaving, blood in the barbasol.
Ruby slippers, technicolor, that point of the Kremlin on the president's desk.
Russian flag, Nazi flag, Chinese flag.
Pomegranates, persimmons, red light district, red tape.
Rouge. Lava, lobster, scorpions.
Stop sign, sports car, blush.
Visera, flame, dead forests.
Pomegranates, red light district, red tape.
Slash your wrist, blood in sink.
Santa Claus.
Satan! So, red.
Exactly.
More than anything. You know what?
What?
Matisse's painting, The Red Studio. It's a picture of his own studio. The walls are brilliant red. The floor and the furniture all red, as if the color had radiated out of them and swallowed everything up. When the modern first put that picture up, I would spend hours looking at it. Day after day, I would go. You could argue that everything I do now, you could trace the bloodlines back to those, that painting in those hours. Just watching it, letting it move. The more I looked, the more it pulsated around me. I was totally saturated. It swallowed me.
Still there.
I can't look at it anymore.
Why not?
It's too depressing.
How can all that red be depressing?
I don't see the red anymore. Even in that painting, that total and profound immersion in red, it's there. The mantle above a dresser, just over the center line. Set off in yellow of all goddamn things. He wanted it inescapable.
What?
Black.
The color black?
The thing black. There's only one thing in life I fear, my friend. One day, black will swallow the red.
He knows I'm a painter, so he's got to be expecting it, but it depends on his mood. I think he's here. I'll talk to you later. Pray for me.
Good morning.
Good morning. I got the other maroon. I'll take over. You finish the canvas. I went to the Seagram building last night. It's coming along.
How's the restaurant?
Still under construction. But they took me around. I got a feel of it.
And?
Too much natural light as always, but it'll work. I made some sketches. I'll find them for
you. You ever wonder it's not the right place for them?
How can it not be the right place when they're being created specifically for that place? Sometimes your logic baffles me.
Read Nietzsche, The Birth of Tragedy, like you said.
Like I said?
Yeah, you said if I wanted to know about Jackson Pollock, I should read The Birth of Tragedy.
I said that?
Yeah.
I don't remember. It's more like something I would say.
So what about Pollock?
First, tell me what you make of the book.
Interesting.
That's like saying read. Don't be enigmatic. You're too young to be enigmatic.
I think I know why you wanted me to read it.
Why?
Because you see yourself as Apollo and you see him as Dionysus.
Don't be so pedestrian. Think more.
Well, Dionysus is the god of wine and movement and transformation. This is Pollock. Wild, rebellious, drunken and unrestrained. The raw experience itself. Apollo is the god of order, method, and boundaries. This is Rothko. Sober, rabbinical, sober and restrained. The raw experience, leavened by contemplation. He splatters paint, you study it. He's Dionysus, you're Apollo.
Yeah, exactly right, but for the time, you're missing the point.
How so?
You missed the tragedy. The point is always the tragedy.
For you.
You really think human beings can be divided up so neatly into character types? You think the multifarious complexities and nuances of the psyche, evolving over countless generations, pervaded and demented by social neuroses and personal anguish, molded by faith, by lack of faith, can really be so goddamn simple? Pollock is emotion, Rothko is intellect. You embarrass yourself. Think more.
Well, maybe it's like one of your paintings.
Most things are, how?
Well, dark and light, order and chaos, existing at the same time in the same plane, pulsing back and forth. We pulse too. We're the subject of both Apollo and Dionysus, not one or the other. We ebb and flow like the colors in your pictures. The ecstasy of the Dionysian at war with the restraint.
Not a war.
Not a war?
Not really a conflict. It's more like symbiosis.
Okay, they need each other. Dionysus' passion is focused, made bearable by Apollo's will to form. In fact, the only way we can withstand Dionysus' emotion is because we have the control and intelligence of Apollo. Otherwise, the emotion would overwhelm us. So back and forth we go, myth to myth, pulsating.
And the perfect light would be perfectly balanced everlastingly on the fulcrum. But we can never achieve that balance. We exist, all of us, for all time, in perpetual dissonance. We long for the raw truth of emotion, but can only endure it with the cool lie of reason. We seek the ephemeral, the miraculous, and try to put it on the canvas, stopping time. But, like an entomologist pinning a butterfly, it dies when we try. We're foolish that way, we human beings. We try to make the red black.
But the black is always there, like the mantle of Matisse.
Like the snow outside the window, it never goes away. Once glimpsed, we can't help being affected by it. Because the intimations of our mortality are... But still, we go on clinging to that tiny bit of hope, that red, that makes the rest endurable.
Or maybe just less unendurable.
That was my friend Jackson Pollock. Finally, it was just unendurable.
What do you mean?
His suicide.
He didn't commit suicide.
Didn't he?
And Polly died in the car accident.
A man gets drunk for years, day after day, hammered. Then he gets into an Oldsmobile convertible and races around these little country roads like a lunatic. You tell me what that is, if not a lazy suicide. Believe me, when I commit suicide, there will be no doubt. No mysterious crumpled card gives me a headache. It's so boring.
When you commit suicide.
What?
You said, when I commit suicide.
No, I didn't.
You did.
You must have misheard. Listen, let me tell you one thing about your hero. That man really did confront his tragedy. He was valiant in the face of it. He endured it as long as he could. But then he tried to recede from life. But how could he? He was Jackson Pollock.
What was his tragedy?
He became famous.
Don't be glib.
His muse evacuated. He grew tired of his form. He grew tired of himself. He lost faith in his viewers. Take your pick. He no longer believed there was any human beings out there to look at his pictures.
How does that happen to me?
Better you should ask how occasionally it doesn't happen.
I mean, he's in Life magazine. He's an artist. He's famous. He's young. He's got money.
That's exactly it. He's a schmuck from Wyoming who can paint. Suddenly, he's a commodity. Let me tell you, that Oldsmobile really did kill Jackson. Not because it crashed, because it existed. Why the fuck did Jackson Pollock have an Oldsmobile convertible?
So artists should starve.
Yes, artists should starve, except me.
Hey, take a look
good ground. Good base layer. Nice and even.
We'll see when it dries, then I can start to paint.
You really care for what I think?
Not at all. What is it?
Nothing.
What?
Doesn't matter.
What?
It's just, I'm just reminded of something. It's just the color.
What about the color?
Doesn't matter.
What is it?
Dried blood. And the blood dried on the carpet, but darker.
Which carpet?
My parents' room. Where he died, it's exactly the color. When the blood dried on the carpet, it got darker. That surprised me. I remember being surprised by that.
What happened to your parents?
I don't want to talk about it.
Yes, you do.
They were murdered.
Did you say murdered?
Yeah.
How old were you?
7. This was back in Iowa.
What happened?
You know, I really don't remember.
Sure you do. What do you see? What do you see?
I got up and I remember the snow outside the window. I was glad it snowed because it was Saturday. My dad would take us out sledding, me and my sister. I couldn't smell anything, that was weird. Because normally my mom would be up and cooking breakfast. It was real quiet. So I got on my slippers, these little neolite ones, like moccasins, you know. Go to the door, go into the hall. And it's real quiet. It's cold. There's a window open somewhere. My sister. Just standing in the hallway. She's at my parents' room and the door's open. She's just staring. Those eyes. I go down and I look in. And the first thing I see is the snow outside the window. Maybe we'll still go sledding. And then the blood. On the floor, on the walls, and on the bed. Then. Knife. I find out later. Knife. Burglars. At least 2 of them. I don't know what to do, but I know I don't want my little sister to see this anymore, so I push her out and I close the door and I'm there on the handle with blood. It's red. That's all.
What happened then?
Went to the neighbors. They phoned the police.
What happened to you two?
State took us foster homes. People were nice, actually. They kept us together, but they shuffled us around a lot, and we were rootless. She's married to a CPA now.
Rootless?
Never had a place. Never belonged.
Did they get the guys who did it?
No. Paint pictures of them sometimes.
You paint pictures of the men who murdered your parents?
Yeah, but I imagine they look like.
Which is what?
Normal.
When I was a kid in Russia, I saw the Cossacks cutting people up and tossing them into pits. At least, I think I remember that. Maybe somebody just told me about it, or I'm just being dramatic. It's hard to say sometimes.
How old were you when you came here?
10. We went to Portland and lived in together with all the other thinky-talky Jews. I was Marcus Rothkovitz then.
Changed your name.
My first dealer said he had too many Jewish painters on the books. So Marcus Rothkovitz became Mark Rothko. Now nobody knows I'm a Jew.
Can I ask you a question?
Can I stop you?
Are you really scared of black?
No, I'm really scared of the absence of light.
Like going blind?
Like going dead. like the East River choked with garbage, all that superficial, meaningless sewage up there on the walls, the same sacred spaces, the cooning, and Motherwell, and Smith, and Newman, and Pollock, and... What is that music?
Chet Baker.
Just when I thought this day couldn't get any worse.
It's jazz.
Like I care. When you pay the rent, you can pick the records.
How was the exhibition?
These young artists, they're out to murder me.
That's a bit extreme, isn't it?
But not inaccurate.
You think Jasper Johns is trying to murder you?
Yes.
What about Paul Stella?
Yes.
Robert Rothenberg?
Yes.
Roy Lichtenstein?
Which one is he?
Connor.
Yes.
Andy Warhol? You sound like an old man.
I am an old man.
Not that old.
Today I'm old.
If you say so.
My point is, my contemporaries, my colleagues, those painters who came up with me, we all had one thing in common. We all understood the importance of seriousness.
Ah, you're too much.
What?
You heard me.
What did you say to me?
Who are you to say they're not serious?
Look at their work.
I have.
Not like you usually look at things like an overeager undergraduate.
I have.
So what do you see?
Never mind.
No, you look at them. What do you see?
This moment, right now.
In all those flags and comic books and soup cans?
This moment right now, and a little bit of tomorrow.
And you think that's good?
It's neither good or bad, it's what people want.
That's exactly my point.
Yeah, so art shouldn't be popular anymore.
It shouldn't only be popular.
Hey, you might not like it, but as many people are genuinely moved now by a Frank Stella as by a Mark Rothko.
That's nonsense.
I don't think so.
You know, the trouble with those painters is exactly what you said. They're painting for this moment, and that's all. It's nothing but zeitgeist art. Completely temporal, completely disposable, like Kleenex, like...
soup cans, like comic books.
Yes.
You ever get fed up telling people what art is?
No, not ever. Until they listen. Better they should tell me fuck off.
You know, you're only mad because the barbarians are at the gate. And what do you know? People seem to like the barbarians.
Of course they like them. That's a goddamn point. You know what people like? They like things to be pretty and beautiful. Jesus Christ, when someone tells me one of my paintings is beautiful, I want to vomit.
What's wrong with pretty?
Pretty, beautiful, nice, fine. That's our life now, isn't it? Fine. How are you feeling? Fine. How was your day? Fine. How did you like the picture? Fine. We are a smirking nation living under the tyranny of fine. How are you? Fine. How was your day? Fine. How are you feeling? Fine. How did you like the picture? Fine. How would you like some dinner? Fine. Well, I'm telling you, everything is not fine. Look at these pictures. Look at them. You see that? Dark rectangle? An aperture like a doorway? Yes, but it's also a gaping mouth, letting out a silent howl of something feral and foul and primal and real. Not nice, not fine, real. A moan of rapture, something divine or damned, something immortal, not comic books or soup cans. Something beyond me and beyond now, whatever it is not fine. I am here to stop your art, you understand that? I'm here to make you think. I'm not here to make pretty pictures.
So said the Cubist, the second before you stomped him to death. Tragic, really, to grow superfluous in your own lifetime, right? The child must banish the father, respect him, but kill him. Isn't that what you said? You guys went after the Cubists and Surrealists, and boy, did you love it. Now it's your turn to go, and you don't want to. Well, exit stage left, Rothko, because pop art has banished abstract expressionism. I only pray to God they have more generosity of spirit than you did, and allow you some dignity as you leave. Consider. The last gasp of a dying race. Futility. Never mind, you can always sign menus for money.
How dare you!
You know where I live?
What?
Do you know where I live?
Oh.
Uptown, downtown, no. Brooklyn. Do you know if I'm married?
No, what is it?
Gay, straight, anything.
What is it?
2 years I've worked here. 8 hours a day, 5 days a week, and you know nothing about me. You ever once asked me out for dinner or to your house? You know I'm a painter, don't you?
Well, I suppose.
You know I'm a painter.
Yes.
You ever once asked to look at my work?
Why should I?
Why should you?
You're an employee. Everything here is about me. You don't like that? Leave right now. Is that what this is about? Baby feels wounded. Daddy didn't pet you on the head. Ma didn't hug you today.
Stop it.
Don't blame me. I didn't kill him.
Stop it.
Go find a psychiatrist and quit whining to me about it. Your neediness bores me.
Bores you? Bores you? Jesus Christ Almighty, try working for you for a living. The talking, talking. Jesus Christ, what do you ever shut up? Titanic self-importance of the man. You stand there trying to look so deep, but you're nothing but a sophistic bully with your Grand West schemes and your lectures and your areas and your... Let's look at the fucking canvas for another week. Let's not paint on it. Let's just fucking look at it. And the pretensions. Jesus Christ, the pretensions. I don't believe there's ever been another artist in history trying so hard to be significant. You know, not everything has to be important all of the time. You know, you don't have to create something that rips out someone's guts and exposes their soul. Not everyone wants art that actually hurts. Sometimes you just want a fucking still life, or a portrait, or a soup can, or a comic book. Which you might understand if you ever left this goddamn hermetically sealed submarine you live in, with all the windows shut and no natural light, because natural light isn't good enough for you. But then nothing's good enough for you. Not even the people who buy your art. Museums are mausoleums, and art galleries are run by crooks and swindlers. And art collectors are nothing but clowns, social climbers. So who's good enough to own your art? Anybody? Or maybe the real question is, who is good enough to even see your art? Is it possible there's no one worthy out there? That's it, isn't it? We've all been weighed in the balance and found wanting. You say you spend your life in search of real human beings with compassion who can look at your art with compassion, but you don't believe they exist anymore. So the black swallows the red. My friend, I don't think you'd recognize a real human being if you're standing right in front of you. Never mind.
Don't give up so easy.
It's not a game.
You do make one salient point, though. Not the one you think.
Oh, naturally.
I do get depressed when I think of how people are going to look at my work if they're going to be unkind. Sending a picture out to the world is like sending a blind child into a room full of razor blades. It's going to get hurt. Doesn't know what hurt. It's never been hurt before. That's why I'm trying to do something different with these ones. They're less vulnerable somehow, more robust, some use from the earth to give them strength. And they are not alone. They will always have each other for protection and safety. And most important, they are going to a place created specifically for them. A place of safety and reflection.
A place of contemplation.
Yes.
A place with no distractions.
Yes.
A secret place.
Yes.
A chapel.
Yes.
Like the Four Seasons restaurant? Jesus Christ, at least Andy Warhol gets the joke.
No, you don't understand.
Oh, what? It's a fancy restaurant in a big high-rise run by a rich corporation. What don't I understand?
You don't understand my intentions.
Your intentions are immaterial. Unless you're going to stand there beside the work giving lectures for the rest of your life, which you'd probably enjoy. The art has to speak for itself.
Yes,
just admit your hypocrisy. The high priest of modern art is painting a wall in the temple of consumption. You rail against commercialism in art, but you're taking the money, pal.
Yes.
Oh, yeah. You can convince yourself it's a sacred place, a contemplative hall, but in reality, it's just a... You're just decorating a dining room for the super rich, and these are nothing but the world's most expensive overmans.
You, why do you think I took this, Camille?
Jesus Christ, what have you done? What have you done? Ah, Christ, it's blood.
It's paint.
It's paint. It's paint. Christ.
I was going to work.
Oh, obviously. Do you want a towel or a paintbrush?
I went there.
Where?
Four Seasons.
Ah.
After a check yesterday, I went there last night for dinner.
Ah.
It's been open a couple of weeks. I thought I should finally take a look.
What did you see? What did you see?
You go in from the 52nd and up some stairs to the restaurant. You hear the room before you see it. Glasses clinking, silverware, voices. Hushed, but building as you get nearer. It's a desperate sound. Like forced gaiety at gunpoint. You go in, feel underdressed, feel too fat, feel too goddamn Jewish for the place. I give you a name. Pretty hostess gives you a look, says, I know who you are. And I'm not impressed. We get millionaires in here, pal. You might as well be some schmuck painting marionettes in Tijuana. She snaps for the maitre d', who snaps for the captain, who snaps for the head waiter, who takes you through the crowd to your table. Heads turning all the time, everyone looking at everyone, like predators. Who are you? What are you worth? Do I need to fear you? Do I need to acquire you? The wine guy comes, speaks French. You feel inadequate, you obviously don't understand. He orders something expensive from the wine guy to impress him. He goes, unimpressed. You look around and everyone else seems to belong. Man with elegant silver hair, woman with capes and gloves. Someone in a uniform comes and gives you the menu. It's things you never heard of! Suckling pig on the glass, quail's eggs in aspic. You are lost! And then, you can't help it. You start to hear what people are saying all around you, which is the worst of all. The voices. It's the chatter of monkeys and the barking of jackals. It's not human. And everyone's all so clever. And everyone's investing in this or investing in that. Everyone's joining this charity board or that charity board. And everyone's jetting off here and there, and everyone's laughing. And no one looks at anything. And no one thinks about anything. They just chatter and bark and eat, and the knives and the fork click and clack, and the words cut, and the teeth snap and snarl. And there, in that place, will live my paintings for all time. I wonder, do you think they'll ever forgive me?
They're only paintings.
Turn that off.
Philip Johnson, please. This is Mark Rothko on the phone. Philip, this is Rothko. Listen, I went to the restaurant last night. Let me tell you, anyone who eats that kind of food in that kind of joint for that kind of money will never look at a painting of mine. I'm sending you the money back and keeping the pictures. Sorry, but that's how it goes. Good luck to you, buddy.
Now, now you're Mark Rothko.
Only poorer.
The money doesn't make you wealthy.
It helps, though.
Oh, this is a day for the books. We're
gonna go fired.
What?
You're fired.
Why?
Doesn't matter.
It does.
Write down your address. I'll send you your final paycheck.
You owe me an explanation.
I don't owe you anything.
Look, I worked here 2 years. You just expect me to walk out the door?
You want a retirement party.
I want a reason.
Look, you're too goddamn needy already. I don't need your need. Since you were 7, you're looking for a home. Well, this is not it. I'm not your father. Your father's dead, remember? Sorry, but that's it.
Come on, Dr. Freud. You can do better than that. Why?
I told you.
Come on, why?
I don't need an assistant.
Bullshit.
You talk too much.
So do you.
You have lousy taste.
Bullshit.
Because I'm sick of you.
Bullshit.
Because your life is out there. Listen, you don't need to spend any time here with me. You need to get out there and find your own contemporaries. Make your own world. Shake your fist at them. Talk their ear off. Okay? When I was starting off, art was a lonely thing. No galleries, no collectors, no agent, no money. We had no mentors, we had no parents, but it was a great time. Because we had nothing to lose and a vision to gain. Okay?
Sure. Thanks.
Go make something new. What do you see?